for your presence, messages of support, prayers, and your love during this most difficult time in our lives. Losing your beloved Father Alan to the call of his life is not that easy, but we have comfort to know that he is resting in a better place, cheering us on in our journey. After all, the Bible tells us that to be absent from the body is to be present with God Almighty. When I think about my father, I remember a loving, caring, and a gentleman who was humble, low-key, but had a big heart to help anyone and everyone, including all living things, and could never say no to anyone. I remember a missionary, a man who loved his country of Sarah and her people. I remember a simple man who would pick up complete strangers on the road and drop them off in the market, give them food and money. I remember a man who fed stray dogs, loved animals, and did his best to look after them. He even cared about the pets, which congregated near our home. My mother, Marina, has many fond memories to tell. A couple of days after Cyclone Peter had blown away all the bananas on our farm, Alan asked her to find some ripe bananas to hang on the trees outside so that the pets would have something to feed on. That was Alan, a loving and a very kind soul. Saying that my father loved my mother is an understatement. He cared for her, adored her, and he did everything possible to ensure she was happy. When Alan left us, they had spent almost 60 years of happiness together as a couple. The story started around 1953, when an 18-year-old Alan came to Samoa and decided to stay to help his mother and baby with the then hotel. It was when he was playing rugby that he would meet the love of his life, Marina Thompson. In those days, he said to me, I had very little money, but whenever I got money, I would go to the bank of Western Samoa, where Marina worked at the time, to bank the money in the hope I would ask her out on a date. But he said he was always too shy. Still, he kept going every day, even though he didn't have any money to bank. Finally, he went to the parish to ask her out. She agreed that their first date was for four. She said, okay, you can pick me up on the stage. On this day, at 7 p.m., my father arrived at 8 p.m. in a big yellow truck, and unfortunately for him, Marina left the ball with her brothers. But they had never gave up. Mum would say that when he would enter the Thompson home in Montauto, he would sit there for hours and say nothing. But that was there. He said very little, but always at the heart of a line. Eventually, he and Marina married in August 1959 at this venue where we are here today, and spent 60 years of marriage and started the young family of Abby, Tanya, and myself. As we all know, my father loved rugby. It started when he was a 9-year-old living in Auckland. He played his first game of rugby for Boston in the under 10s. On the wing. And I remember him telling me that when he came to pick the ball out, he missed the ball and fell over. From that day on, he was self-directing and went on to Captain Avondale College in Spursity while he was still on the fifth floor. In that team, he had numerous future all-blacks. From his young age, he went on to represent Auckland and their other 3-1 side. The likes of his good friend Brian Grey. He He skipped 6 at 7 form and was enrolled directly at Auckland University, where he was to study industrial chemistry. Alan was always adventurous. He was known for skipping many of his classes, so he could run away to sail on a ride up the harbour in Auckland by himself. Despite spending little time at school, he managed to captain the first 15, be the head boy, and get accepted at university 2 years before he finished college. That was the character of Alan. But his destiny was elsewhere, and God knew. While he was waiting to start university, he got a message from his mother, Aggie, to return home for the holidays. She had not seen her youngest son, her youngest child, for many years, and she had often seen him. He returned to Samoa in 1953, and saw that his mother was alone and was struggling with the old Aggies at the time. It was then and there that he decided to stay and help his mother with her boarding house. The rest is history. Alan played a critical role in the development of the hotel, so that it became one of the most famous hotels in the world. He wrote the lists for the whole time and never saw any praise. Rather, he preferred to give the credit to his mother. Well, the start of helping his mother, he began to return to his passion of playing rugby. He played many years at number 10 for Bayern. His feats on the field are second to none. You still hear stories of the smallest number 10 on the field with the biggest mark. While playing for Bayern, he also had the honor of playing number 10 for Samoa against Tonga. In those days, tests between Samoa, Fiji and Tonga were rare, due to each team having to travel to each island by boat. But words of his talents and skill reached New Zealand, many people who knew that he wondered how far he could have gone as a rugby player if he had chosen to stay in New Zealand. But there was never a doubt itself. He will always put his family first, or a complete stranger over himself. He did the same when he got married, and when he and Marina raised a young family. He gave up playing rugby, but went on to coach Tuila'epa for many years. And under his guidance, he became one of the most successful clubs in Samoa, winning championship after championship. With his success with Tuila'epa, he took the first Samoa rugby team on an official tour to New Zealand as coach in 1976, where they lost every match with the exception of winning against West Coast Wallaby. In years later, he would say to me, "You know, son, if ever you get to the South Island of New Zealand, go to West Coast Wallaby. Nice place, isn't it?" In response, I'd say, "What was so nice about it?" He'd say, "Well, actually, it was the only place in Manu Samoa at the time, won a game. And on our New Zealand tour, even though we bumped against some locals, they bought us much beer all night long." Alan would continue coaching the Manu Samoa and other tournaments, like the 1976 South Pacific Games, when the first American All Blacks tour at Samoa, and the 1983 South Pacific Games, and so on. With the love of rugby, he's so entrenched in it that he would go to the rugby union, where he became a treasurer, then secretary, and for many, many years, a chairman. It was always his dream to see Samoa coming to the world stage in rugby. Under Alan, Samoa went to his first Hong Kong Sevens tournament, but he wanted more. After the 1987 inaugural World Cup in New Zealand, he set his mind on getting Samoa to the next World Cup. I recall at the mum and I said, you know what, if Fiji can go to the first World Cup, then so can Samoa. My mum replied, but Ellen, how can Samoa rugby go to the World Cup on their own when the union has no money? The reply to both of us was, I will have to fund it myself. And sure enough, he did. He was true to his word. I don't have to remind all of you today what we achieved. Suffice to say, Samoa made two quarterfinals for the World Cup, and one of the prestigious Hong Kong centers. And believe it or not, the rugby union office consisted of Peter Yomaya as the secretary, Dr. Alonjo Abel as the CEO, and YRIP. Their offices were located next to Alan's office at the old Amics. That was Alan. He was a man who had critical luck in many things he did, from business to rugby to animals. Speaking of animals, his dog run around the pool still continues to this day. He would feed all the neighbors' dogs of Iceland, all the way up to Afiman. People would joke saying that the price is far than Afiman, and there were hundreds of dogs waiting from 5 year onwards for Alan to come in his red four truck and feed them. He would then feed his pigs, cats, chickens, and his cattle. One day I said to him, Dad, how come you like going to a farm and being with the animals? What's the big attraction in that? He would reply, he said, you know what, son, you have a lot to learn. You see, I like it up here, as when I'm dealing with humans and listening to their problems. When I come out to the farm and I'm with my animals, they listen to me. They love me, they're warm, and above all else, they don't talk back to me like humans do. His other love was the people. Dad woke up anywhere, whether it was seeing Samoa, New Zealand, anywhere. And he gave up all the time to help me. The word no never existed to Alan. One day he and I went to watch a rugby match in Auckland. It was Auckland playing under Waikato at Eden Park. And at half time, they had an announcement for a draw. When the draw was announced, the winning seat was Alan's seat. There was a box of rugby jerseys and Auckland rugby union memorabilia. Next to us was a kid my age, all alone at the time. The kid next to us started to jump up and down with excitement, but then slumped back down to his seat in sadness, knowing the seat that won the prize was ours. At that stage, Dad turned to me and said, son, go to the canteen downstairs and hurry. The meat pies may run out. Then I said, Dad, what about the prize you just won? He said, don't worry, get the meat pies and come back. So off I went and came back with the meat pies. I said, what about the prize? Do you want me to go get it? His reply, no, no, son. I said, why is that? He said, I gave it away. I said, you what? He said, yes, I gave it away. And I said, why did you do that? He looked at me and said, did you see how excited that kid next to us was when he thought he had a winning seat number? And then how sad he looked when he saw the winning seat in my seat. That kid, according to Alan, had a big smile on his face. And as the second half of the game began, that kid had gone to collect Alan's prize and never returned for the last 20 minutes of the game. Years later in London, I would visit a law firm. While I was discussing some matters with his lawyer, he stopped and said, you wouldn't know an Alan Grey, would you? And I said, yes, he's my father. And why is that? I asked. The lawyer looked at me and he said, incredible guy, I said, "Why is that?" The lawyer replied, "I'm bound by confidentiality rules, so I won't mention my client or who they were." So I said, "Was Alan your client?" And he replied, "No, he wasn't, but he made my client very happy." I said, "Why is that?" He said, "Well, someone was about to lose their house to the bank. Worst fact for that matter. But Alan would know I got a fax from this guy in Samoa, asking for the bank's bank details, saying he would pay off the loan in full." The lawyer said he looked at the address that was from Samoa. So his initial thought was, this must be some broker in Samoa. So he replied, "We have the bank's details in full clock. This must be a joke, but I did it anyway," he said. To the lawyer's surprise, the bank called and said that loan for a deceased person has been paid off in full by Mr. Alan Gray from Simon. The lawyer looked at me at the time and said, "What happened next after the payment was made?" "Was nothing, just an incredible gesture by a kind and generous human being." I replied to the lawyer that you never spoke to Alan. His reply was, "No, just a letter from him faxed to me, and that was it." That was Alan. There are countless people that went to him for loans to guarantee their loans, countless in fact, and he never said no to anyone, even when they defaulted. Many of them never paid it back. But Alan paid to help these people. Many of those who had no land, or no way for them, he bought land for them and gifted it to them. He was always about the people first and then last. He would always say to his son, "Life's all about living, all about helping your fellow human being, and above all else, being honest and sincere to everyone. No matter how rich, how poor, or what color they are, everyone's the same to me. I was born a simple man. I will walk and die a simple man. But never forget, treat people with respect and humility." Dad, I can stand here all day, all week, and keep talking about the love of people, especially your love for the people of Samoa. But I know everyone here today, and everyone who was blessed to mention and got to know you, knew what kind of man you are. You battled on with humans, and even in your last days and last hours, you were shaking everyone's hand, kissing everyone and giving them a thumbs up, joking with the nurses, thanking them, thanking the doctors, and asking Mum, "Marina, you have to come out of this nurse. Marina, can you give this nurse some money?" Before I finish, on behalf of my mother Marina, Sister Amy and I, and our family that are here from overseas, I want to acknowledge the gratitude of the team to poor them assisting in all their hospitals, who did a fantastic job to look after our father in his last days. From the ambulance room, to the emergency staff, doctors, nurses, and the ICU team, you are incredible. Thank you very much. Dad, how can we never forget you? You are a small man with the biggest heart of them all, a one in a million. Your blood is worth holding because you are a rare human being. You were all about giving and helping Samoa. What a legacy. Samoa will have to wait a long time for another person like you to come. But today we are confident that we know that you are home with the Virgin Mary, whom you love so much. She came to take you to be at peace. We will sorely miss you, Dad. Mom, all of us will always love you. In Malielegaoi,
God bless you, Madam.
Ma a ti lava le nei per
Most importantly, for the poor,